Services and Beyond. And we have three presentations. Professor Max Skidmore is the University of Missouri Curator's Distinguished Professor and Thomas Jefferson Fellow. He received his PhD in American Studies from the University of Minnesota and is a prolific scholar, particularly on poverty and inequality, and once served in a management position in the Social Security Administration. And his presentation is going to be on the Social Security Act, the crown jewel of the New Deal.
Thank you very much. Social insurance reaches back to the 1880s in Europe, but the United States was rather late in coming around. There were some programs prior to this, targeted programs and programs of more limited effect, but the Social Security program itself didn't come until 1935, and both Democrats and Republicans supported the act, but Republicans formed the bulk of the opposition. For example, in the Senate, 15 Republicans voted in favor and 5 opposed, but just prior to that, Republicans voted 12-8 to eliminate the program. In the 1936 election, the Republican Party platform charged that the Social Security Act was unworkable, that its tax burdens would be too great and it would benefit too few people. Republican nominee Kansas Governor Alf Landon called it a cruel hoax, and that's a term that opponents have seized on and used for every program they don't like ever since. Use it against Medicare and so forth. FDR's landslide victory brought overt criticism of Social Security by elected officials to an end, for a time anyway, creating the notion that the program was the third rail of American politics. You touch it and you die. FDR in 1936 was one of only 4 presidents in American history to reach 60% of the popular vote. If you don't know a lot about presidential politics, you think of a landslide election, you think, oh, 85, 90%. No. Only 4 presidents have ever touched 60%. Franklin Roosevelt in 1936, Richard Nixon in 1932, LBJ in 1964. He's the only one to touch 61%. And I suspect in this august group, there are those who can guess who the fourth was. Hang on to your hats. Warren Harding in 1920. The original legislation set up other programs, but we won't go into those here. The 1950 amendments that President Harry Truman, first the 1939 amendments, expanded the program before it was ever actually paying benefits. The program was adopted in 35, tax rates started in 1937 to build up a fund, but in 1950, benefits were scheduled to begin in 1942, but the trust funds were getting, or at least the accumulated funds were getting so large that both Republicans and Democrats thought it was better economically to get that money back out into circulation. So in the 1939 amendments, they moved earlier the date for benefit payments to 1942 instead of 1942, and they added insurance, life insurance, survivors' benefits, and benefits for spouses, or at that time it was only for wives, later added to change to include spouses in general. The 1950 amendments that President Harry Truman signed into law actually established the foundation for Social Security to become the virtually universal program that it is now. They increased benefits, they added large numbers of people previously not included, such as farmers, farm workers, domestic workers, and self-employed. And at that time, Social Security began a period in which Congress regularly adopted a number of improvements and expansions. And in those years, it still was necessary to get a law in order to raise benefits. Now they are raised automatically according to the Consumer Price Index, although as of the recent tax cut, they have changed very sneakily. I have heard no real mention of this. They've changed it to the so-called chained CPI, which means that everybody's Social Security check is going to go up at a slower rate over the years. You won't notice it the first year or two, but after that, it's going to be a very large benefit reduction. The largest addition wasn't the addition of disability benefits in 1956, but it was a very large one signed into law by Republican President Dwight Eisenhower, disability benefits. The largest addition, of course, was Medicare, although people usually don't associate that with Social Security. It is the title of the Social Security Act. And as early as Theodore Roosevelt's proposals back in 1910, and then in his platform for his bull moose race, he said, "I feel as strong as a bull moose." So they called his Progressive Party the Bull Moose Party. And as far back as that, there were suggestions for universal health care. For a brief period, roughly a century ago, even the American Medical Association gave some consideration to universal health care, but that was very brief, and it came to an abrupt halt. By the 1920s, the AMA had become a fervent foe of any government payment for health care. When FDR and his New Dealers were creating the structure for Social Security, the president had hoped to include health care as one of the benefits. But Frances Perkins, his Secretary of Labor, the first woman, by the way, to serve in the cabinet, she and others reported to the president that the AMA had signaled that the organization would not oppose the Social Security Act. It wouldn't take a position on it. It wouldn't oppose it unless it included health care, in which case it would do everything possible to kill it. And at that time, it was the most powerful. It was the NRA of the day before, not the National Recovery Act, but the National Rifle Association of that day, the most powerful lobbying group. And FDR prudently decided that as much as he wanted health care, it was better to have Social Security and not have health care than not have Social Security or health care, which would have been the result had he tried to add Social Security. On the 12th of April, 1945, FDR died. President Harry Truman, his vice president, stepped in and became president as the 25th Amendment later made sure was the case. And he had hoped to expand the New Deal. FDR in 1944 had called for an economic bill of rights to include such things as a decent living and a job for everyone who wanted to work, decent housing for everyone, education, health care for everyone, and so forth and so forth. It still sounds visionary today, almost three quarters at least of a century later. Harry Truman tried to expand it, was unable to do so for a variety of reasons, not least of which was in the 1946 elections, conservatives took over both houses of Congress. And Truman's great success was in preventing the New Deal from being rolled back. His successor, Dwight Eisenhower, adopted what he called modern republicanism, which meant that the Republican Party should accept New Deal programs, not try to roll them back, be cautious about programs beyond that, but that the New Deal programs had become part of the American way of life. Universal health care, that was a step too far. His successor, though, John Kennedy, took office in January of 1961, and he was far less ideological regarding social measures than Eisenhower had been. Eisenhower was so cautious, he had to ascertain that any given program wasn't socialism before he could support it. If it weren't socialism, it was okay, he could support it. Disability benefits through Social Security, fine. Medicare, I'm not sure about that. Kennedy was another matter. He pulled out all the stops. He tried very vigorously. His truncated presidency was too short to permit him to have success. Although, even if he had lived, he had not. Kennedy was an incredibly bright guy, and he evolved rapidly as president, becoming a very good president, but he had not demonstrated extraordinary legislative skills as president, nothing like, say, LBJ subsequently, or FDR, or Woodrow Wilson for that matter. But he was personally committed. He tried hard, but had not succeeded by the time he was tragically assassinated. Fortunately for Medicare, and probably for civil rights and other great society programs, his successor was Vice President, then President, Lyndon B. Johnson, a legislative genius. LBJ succeeded and in 1965 signed legislation creating Medicare and Medicaid. But as early as 1954, opposition to health coverage and also to Social Security itself had begun to coalesce around an increasingly prominent, very charismatic, anti-Social Security spokesman. And that person was a former actor employed by General Electric to speak at hundreds of banquets around the country and then to host GE Theater on television. You may have heard the name Ronald Reagan. As part of GE's PR efforts, Reagan developed what he himself called simply the speech. He gave it thousands and thousands of times, speaking from 3x5 cards, shuffling them, depending, emphasizing this as opposed to that, depending on which audience he was addressing. In it, he warned of the dangers of communism, the evils of big government, the threat of centralization, the burden of high taxes, and along with those themes, he decried more than three quarters of a century ago, the failure of Social Security. You didn't know it had failed three quarters of a century ago. By the early 1960s, Social Security and healthcare became increasingly prominent portions of the speech, especially when he spoke to select audiences. Before general audiences, he tended to soft-pedal some of these criticisms. In 1964, the speech became the nucleus of his electrifying speech on nationwide television for Republican presidential candidate Barry Goldwater. Although Goldwater lost, Reagan won, going on in 1966 to win the election to two terms as the governor of California, and then in 1980 to be elected president of the United States. When Reagan became president in 1981, he moved immediately to slash Social Security drastically. His actions as president led to a political firestorm. He did succeed in trimming benefits somewhat. For example, children of deceased wage earners can draw Social Security until they're 18. At that time, if they were in college, they could draw until they were 21. But there was a growing hostility toward college students in those days, and so they cut out the college benefit. It no longer exists. By 1982, a cash flow problem did exist, did develop in Social Security, and there were some fears that without revisions, the trust funds would be inadequate to pay full benefits by late 1983. As many experts have noted, the system's troubles were far less severe than the media, which often reported dire predictions from special interest groups as though they were absolute fact, as the media portrayed them. Reagan honored his earlier promise not to make another attack on Social Security, and he didn't. He called together, in good faith, a bipartisan commission to recommend action that included Republican Senator Bob Dole of Kansas and Democratic Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan of New York. They were the leads. The president also named Alan Greenspan as its chair, thus conferring the unofficial name of the Greenspan Commission on this group. The commission took only months to issue its report. The members unanimously rejected privatization. They rejected means testing. They rejected other radical revisions to the system and gave a full vote of confidence to Social Security's fundamental principles, contributory social insurance. Among the recommendations were subjecting half of Social Security's benefits to income tax, except for low-income recipients. And previously, all Social Security benefits had been completely free from income tax. Under the Clinton administration, that amount subject to tax was raised to 85%, so only 15% of your Social Security benefits now are exempted if you are above a certain income level. Congress accepted the recommendations, and they added an enormous benefit cut, which took the form of a raising of the age for full retirement from 65 to 67, which means that any given retiree will receive benefits for two fewer years, unless the person retires early. You can still retire at 62, but you take a much greater hit if you retire at 62 now, since you're retiring 5 years early instead of 3 years early. I recommend anyone who can afford it to wait until 67, or preferably to 70, because if you wait until 70, your check will be vastly greater, even though if you count on living just for a few months, then go ahead and take it. If you're unlucky and have a long life, then you're too much better off by waiting until 70. Those born in 1960 or later are the ones that have the 67 retirement age instead of 65. If you're born in 1938, your retirement age is 65 in 2 months, so it goes up gradually until those born in 1960. Reagan signed the 1983 amendments, and in a letter to Commission member Bob Dole, said the law, quote, demonstrates for all time our nation's ironclad commitment to Social Security. It assures the elderly that America will always keep the promises made in troubled times a half century ago. It assures those who are still working that they too have a pact with the future and that they will receive their fair share of benefits when they retire. Well, that's wonderful language. And it's that language that has caused many people to believe Ronald Reagan was a savior of Social Security. Don't believe it. He did everything he could to try to trim back and, if possible, eliminate the program. It simply was that he could not. His long record of anti-Social Security rhetoric, in fact, created the current conditions that make it at least somewhat acceptable politically to condemn Social Security and not be not face electrocution, which the third rail previously had suggested would happen. For a real understanding of how an enormously successful and popular program has come under such attack and why it is that people now, although they are still, studies indicate, very, very supportive of Social Security, they are very, very doubtful that it's sustainable. And why? It's because they've been subjected to a barrage of anti-Social Security propaganda funded by the Koch brothers, by the mellifluously named Peter G. Peterson, the late former Commerce Secretary under Richard Nixon briefly, and so forth. A multi-billionaire who, for some reason, was an anti-Social Security zealot. Nancy McLean has contributed superbly with her Democracy in Chains. I see it's being displayed in the display over here. Her groundbreaking critique of the connection with Southern segregation of public choice economic theories of the late economist James McGill Buchanan, and its startling influence in generating anti-government ideology. But looking back at 1983 gives us a starting point. The Cato Institute, a free market libertarian, and that means quasi-anarchist, I'm not joking, I'm serious. The Cato Institute was rather new to Washington. It had been founded in 1974 in Wichita, where the Koch brothers are, and moved to San Francisco in 77 and settled in D.C. in 1981. One of the Koch brothers, Charles, brought Koch wealth and was a key founder of the Koch. I mean, of the, I'll start to say the Koch Institute, it's the Cato Institute. In 1983, Cato's journal devoted a full issue to articles attacking Social Security. And listen to these points that he brought out. Two writers from the ultra-conservative Heritage Foundation, Stuart Butler and Peter Germanis, were the authors of the most influential article there or elsewhere. It set forth a plan that has dominated public discourse on Social Security reform ever since, and arguably is responsible for the widespread opinion that seems to have convinced subsequent generations that the belief that the system is unsustainable. The article offered a blueprint for dismantling Social Security. Do not attack the elderly. They're greedy geezers. They fight. They get mad. You don't want to rile them up because they will vote against you and so forth. What you do is reassure them. Promise them that their benefits will be safe. Oh, you mean we only have to sell our children and grandchildren down the river? We can be safe in our benefits? Yay, that's assure anyone, if you're 55 or older, you're close. And if you notice, that has dominated reform discussions ever since. Oh, your benefits won't be harmed if you're already getting them or if you're near to them. In 2012, when you had about 500 Republican congressional presidential debates, every Republican candidate said 55 and over, no diminution. But we have to go after Social Security's benefits, except one, the suicidal candidate, Rick Santorum. He said, we should cut everybody's benefits right now, and you see how much success he got from that. Anyway, the second point was to create all kinds of financial instruments, 401ks and so forth, that you can sell to people as being superior to Social Security. And the third is embark upon a massive educational campaign, it's called a propaganda campaign, to kill Social Security. Anyway, to make a long paper short, what very few people know is that every year the projections that come out, the pundits treat so delicately and as if they are from an oracle on high, every year you are told that 2032, 2034, 2040, 2029, whatever is going to be the doomsday date at which the trust funds are eliminated. Well, if the trust funds are exhausted, you still have all the tax money coming in. And at worst, it would mean a diminution of benefits, not a bankruptcy, which is not an appropriate term to use for a federal government program. But if you notice, that kind of propaganda is out there. It inundates the media. It inundates you, and it dominates the media. There are all these kinds of financial instruments, and they are promised that your benefits will be safe. Now, what people don't know is that there are three projections, not just the one. And there's also a so-called low-cost projection, and that projection, with one exception, has always said the trust funds are never going to be depleted. And I will show you, for example, this is a typical. I have an appendix here showing where the that one that goes up like that is the one that says, you know, trust funds are always going to be safe. Even if they're not safe, a little tax increase would take care of any shortfall, or a removal of the cap on wages subject to FICA tax would take care of any shortfall. But you never hear that. So we are being given misinformation, and it's done so deliberately because of enormously well-funded propaganda campaigns by people who simply don't like public programs, no matter what the result is.